Spencer, you are now rocking with me.
The judge sentenced Jamal Shine Barrow to 10 years in prison today.
I wanted to ask you, how did you get out of your deal with Bad Boy? Like, when you got arrested, when you got locked up, is that when your whole contract with Bad Boy was ended, or how did that go?
Yeah, when the dude told on me, you feel me? He sent witnesses to trial to testify against me and all that. I was facing 25 years, so, you know, anybody that would play with my life like that, you know, like, it's not, it wasn't even a question. He knew what he had to do. I'm not no rapper. My life was for real, you know, I let that thing go off, so he knew what it was, you know, so, I mean, you know, that wasn't even a negotiation, a deliberation, like, you know, you told on me, so if you want to stay alive, like, you know.
What would be your reaction once you get out, and being that you're in the industry and things being the way they are and everything, you happen to run across Puff, what would be your reaction?
I'm going to be on bail, homie. So, I mean, I got Gangland Records, you know, the good people at Island Def Jam and Universal, my man Kev, you know, they invested a lot of money, you know, in me as a businessman, you know, so I'm a chairman of a company, and I got some responsibility, so I couldn't even play myself, you know, whatever animosity I got, I moved on, you know what I mean?
Right.
I got a business to run. I mean, obviously, I'm not going to be taking a nigga hand and popping no bubbly with him, you
right.
feel me? And he,
right.
you know, he going to have about 10 minutes to leave, whatever I'm at.
So, I mean, has he even tried to do anything to help you in a situation?
Absolutely not. You feel me? And I mean, it's not that he told do. Like, I faced 25 years. You know, like, 25's a lot of fucking time, man. And for nigga to be facing, he was facing probation. For you to try to jeopardize 25 years of my life over probation, there's nothing you could do. There's no money in the world that would allow me to stay in business with him. There's no money in the world that would allow me to get right with him. It's just like he violated the ultimate rules, man, and I live by honor.
Well, Shine, this is Charlamagne Tha God, the man you called a slut on Twitter.
Oh, yeah, the one that got stuck up by finger point. Yeah, I heard about
that. That wasn't true, but you know.
That wasn't true, but listen, man, this is what I want to understand, right? My whole thing is consistency, right?
Okay.
Like, Shine has never been inconsistent. You dig? Like I was on the island. I was in the mountains. Like, you know what I'm saying? You never heard nothing reckless about me. You understand what I'm talking about? Like there's no there's no holes poked in what I do and what I represent. You know what I'm saying? When I came out, the records was trash. I admit that. You did? Because I lost my voice. But we can't start comparing records to real life and what I actually did. You understand? My credibility.
No, Shine, listen, your street credibility has never been in question. But from a musical standpoint, that's all I ever critique you on. The music you put out is garbage.
It was trash. You got to listen to that Gangland album. That Gangland album is what it is.
Where's that at?
That's on Dat Piff. I got a couple hundred thousand downloads on GP. That's just self-financing. But listen to that Gangland album, and then we're going to have a follow-up conversation.
Yeah, I haven't heard that yet.
Now,
I got the joint with Pusha T, the Maya Lansky joint. That's Hard White.
Now, you commented on Kendrick Lamar, and you said you didn't like Kendrick Lamar's album.
Yeah, but listen, this is another thing when I'm talking about the consistency. Come on, Envy. I was in the pen for 10 years. I don't need an award. I don't need a trophy. But while I was in the pen, I never used to be doing no interviews. Everybody used to be getting at me. MTV, XXL, all that. I fell back. I ain't had nothing to say. I did my time, and that was it. So when it comes to me making an opinion heard just to get attention or just because I want to be relevant, come on, that's not Poe. I got 5 XXL covers. These dudes is new. They knew Jags. They knew on the scene. I don't got nothing to prove. Like, I'm good. You know, my name is in the books. People can say what they want, regardless of the mediocre product that was put out due to me losing my voice from that 10-year bid. You know, everybody done went on record and said the first two albums is classic. They could front now. You know what I'm saying? Rick Ross done went on record, said it was classics. The Game, you know, who's my protege, that's Mini-Me. Like, you listen to his first records when he came out. You couldn't tell the difference between me and him. You understand what I'm talking about?
See, you know, Sean, when I hear you say that, it reminds me of when you came out and people say, oh, he sounds like Big. I don't hear Game. I don't hear you when I hear Game.
I would never, you know, go in on Big. Like, you couldn't do that. That's the god of rap. But listen, this is what I'm trying to say. I'm just talking about the inconsistency, right? So first, every record that Game rap is, oh, I'm doing my time with Shine. Oh, Free Shine. Oh, I'm a smuggle Shine out of Belize. I was just on his California Republic album. So how you go from being my biggest cheerleader, right, endorsing me, you understand, Free Shine, 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 to now, you know, you have this issue and that issue.
Well, he said the issue came from you getting that Kendrick Lamar.
Yeah,
he felt that Kendrick Lamar is not that type of individual that is a beefing type. So he was standing up for Kendrick Lamar.
Kendrick Lamar become Angela Lee. That's like me talking about a chick and then somebody step me like, yo, nah, you can't talk to my sister like that. Like, what he jumping
But Kendrick
out
is a kid, Sean. Kendrick is a kid. Kendrick ain't no gangster rapper. He's not. If a gangster rapper comes at Kendrick, I can understand another gangster rapper stepping
but
up.
But do you feel like Sean came at Kendrick, or do you feel like he just said he didn't?
No, but listen, Game ain't no gangster rapper. He's a dude with a butterfly on his face and a tongue ring. That's what they said he had. Well, he used to be a stripper. Like, these dudes is fronting, man. Like, all that 40 Glock, that's a joke. Like, I don't know what part of the hood he from, but in Compton and South Central, dudes ain't letting you walk away. I know they're not letting you walk away in Brooklyn. You understand? If you get lucky and it ain't no gunplay, you going in a coma, you going to be brain dead, all your fronts going to be missing, eye sockets, broken jaws, something. Like what world do we live in? What culture do we live in where he let homeboy walk away and everybody thinks he's a gangster? I don't get that. But back to the Kendrick Lamar kid, I did not attack that young man on no gangster move. I didn't make a mob play on him. I didn't say, yo. I said, yo, listen, you're talented. You got super potential. But I thought that the album was trash. Now, that was in response to the overwhelming hype that I felt. Like, you know what I'm saying? I don't pay too much attention to rap culture. But, like, everywhere I seen some dude get up on there and say, yo, he's the Bob Dylan of rap, and this is the most amazing record they ever heard. So, me, I was expecting that. So when I didn't get that, my response was into the disappointment of everything that they had beat it up to be. But I never said he was whack. I never said he was trash. I just said the album was not that. That ain't no classic album, man.
Well, Sean, you should know better than anybody. You can't believe the hype. Come on now. And I mean, and I was the same way. Everybody was hyping it up. But I didn't listen to none of that. I just listened to the album from just a biased perspective. And I think the album's dope. I think it's really dope.
All right, but listen, at the end of the day, that's what art is. Art is subjective. Like, we could have all moved on. But, you know, for homeboy to take this into the level that he's taking into, he's a whore. Like, that's straight media whore stuff.
So you guys haven't had a conversation with each other behind the scenes at all about this? Because being that you guys had a relationship?
No, because he's a whore. Listen, let me show you how consistent I am with it. I remember, he's such a whore when he was talking records about Jigga, right? But I just want to show you my consistency. When he did that, when I came out the pen, that's when he was saying, oh, Shine signed to Black Wall Street. You could go do your research. Oh, Shine signed to Black Wall Street and Zon Entertainment, Shine, Shine, Shine. So I told him when I got on the phone, because me and Hov is all right. Hov always showed me love when I was in the pen. He came to see me on the island. And me and him is all right. I got super respect for old boy. So I told him, I said, yo, listen, you can't be going at Hov like that. You got to fall back. You know what I'm saying? That's my man. You got to fall back. And if you notice, he apologized to Hov. He had fell back. He had said, ooh, but then he goes back again and start talking about Beyonce and start talking crazy. He is inconsistent and not mentally stable. Nobody would walk around and behave the way he behaved if they had sense. You got kids. You making a little bit of paper. You famous. What you running around like you Floyd Mayweather and you Pacquiao? You a boxer now? Like, come on, man, knock it off. You ain't gangster, you understand? And you ain't a boxer. Stop, because I spent 10 years in prison because of that type of gung-ho, you know, wanton, like just ready to, in broad daylight, pop off. That's not cool, man. Ain't nothing fly about
that. So why do you glorify it, Sean? You glorify the fact that you popped your pistol in the club.
No, I don't glorify that. I came out and I went to Israel. But then when I do that, then y'all say I'm crazy. They making fun of my side locks, even though King David got side locks. And a lot of the Pyrus and Lokes, they got their little braids hanging from the side. But then, you know, and then when Rick Ross say he's doing the Black Bar Mitzvah, then it's cool. Like, come on, man.
How did you feel about that Rick Ross mixtape? Because I think a lot of people are upset about that.
Well, it was. I wasn't upset about it. Well, the GDs is on him. You understand? Because he ain't a gangster. He ain't a gangster disciple. And they on him. They on him for that. I was on him for the fact that when I did it, just like you got this little whore talking right now, oh, you got sidelines. Like, what dude be paying attention to do a hairstyle? I just want to point that out. But anyway, when Shine is Jewish, oh, Shine's a fake Jew, Shine's this. But now when Rick Ross come with it, after I dropped Meyer Lansky, which is the biggest Jewish mafia ever, right? So now first homeboy was Teflon Don, John Gotti. Now Shine and Pusha T put out Meyer Lansky. Now he's the Jewish mafia. I'm just saying, he jocking me, and I just wanted to put it out all the geeks.
Yeah. Shine, why do you wear the yarmulke cocked to the side like a Yankees hat? And then I saw you had the Kango over the yarmulke the other day.
Yo, listen, man. Listen, this is what I do. Like, this is what I'm trying to say. I'm just consistent with it. When I was in prison, I didn't become Muslim. All my homeboys is Muslim. I got respect for everybody's religion and everybody's faith. But I'm consistent. These dudes can never beat me because I have integrity and honor. And everything Shine does is truth. I was in the yard, in population. You understand? Lifting weights, doing the bar, you know, watching TV, walking around the yard with my yarmulke, like what? Smoking a Cohiba with the mafia bosses. I'm consistent, man. You understand? I'm going to be me.
Nope.
Being a Jew is not a white thing. It's not a Caucasian thing. You have Jews from Iran, from Syria, from Lebanon, from all over the world. It's a God thing. That's
now,
my faith.
What about your relationship with Diddy?
Yeah, because you said you consistent. You talk about consistency, but you was consistently dissing Diddy. Then y'all got cool again. Then you started dissing him again. That's inconsistent, Shine.
Listen. He reached out to me and he apologized to me. He been apologizing to me. And he reached out to me and apologized to me. And contrary to whatever, you know, misinterpretation y'all are having, I'm not about, you know, glorifying, you know, black-on-black crime and black-on-Spanish crime. I'm not into all that. The bottom line is if I have to defend myself, I'm going to do what needs to be done. You understand? It's you or me, then you going to go. But at the end of the day, I want to take the opportunity to show, you know, African-Americans and Latin Americans that it ain't have to be all that. You dig that we can move on and we could do something positive and productive. So my idea was that me and him was going to go around and talk to kids and try to do, you know, philanthropic work and, you know, inspire kids like in the South Side of Chicago, blah, 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 blah. But that's not what he had in mind. You understand? For him, it was just a photo op. For him, it was just, you know, I don't know what he got going on in this. But he's not into things like that. He ain't into helping the communities and lifting these kids up. For him, it was just, you know, I guess maybe a sigh of relief that he got the guilty conscience away. But moving forward, he wasn't really into that. And for me, it wasn't enough for us to just say sorry and that's it. Like, you know what I'm saying? You owe me. You know, that's 10 years. And again, it's not you owe me because I fired a gun. You owe me because you called a witness to testify against me when I was defending myself and yourself and your broad and everybody that was there. You know what I'm saying?
Let me ask a question, Shine.
Now that the case is over, everything's done, you served your time, what happened that night?
I mean, well, you know, first of all, Natanya Rubin, you know, who was the only innocent bystander, she was a friend of mine, you know what I'm saying? She, you know, me and her used to go to the studio with my homeboy Manny, Imani Haley, you know, and that's the only thing that I really regret, although there's no proof that it was my ratchet that hit her because according to the government and according to all the witnesses, it was a few guns going off that night. You understand? I tried to shoot one guy, and that was the guy that was with Scar that was yapping. That's the kid Julius Jones that got clapped in the shoulder. So despite all the little rappers that's rhyming and talking about, oh, shooting in the ceiling, that's after I clapped one dude and the security guard went to grab me, then the ratchet went off in the ceiling. You dig?
Why didn't the security do their job, first of all?
I mean, you know, we're talking about the club security, so club security ain't really built like that. You understand? When I see somebody move for a ratchet, I'm clapping, and I know Scar. He did, even though he ended up telling on me and his man ended up telling on me, you know, even the biggest mobsters, they roll over, but that don't mean they ain't a mobster.
So
Sammy the Bull had 20 bodies, so, you know, he let that thing off, but he's still a rat at the end of the day, so I knew Scar and them from Brooklyn, I knew what they were about. So I know all this loud talking ain't going to go but so far before somebody starts squeezing off. So when I seen old boy reach for that ratchet, I reached for mine and I popped him in the shoulder. And then they grabbed me and that's when the ratchet went off in the ceiling, when other ratchets was going off. But at the end of the day, he was doing the same thing this kid, Jason Taylor, doing right now. He was loud-mouthing. All of them was loud-mouthing. And listen, if I'm with Sean Combs, I'm with Sean Combs. And ain't going to be too much loud-mouthing and ain't nobody gonna threaten us, and ain't nobody gonna put our lives at risk, and that's how that thing happened.
Did Diddy ever fire a gun that night?
Nah, Diddy ain't fire no gun.
So I didn't even know somebody really got shot. I really thought you was just shooting in the ceiling and it was the bullet.
Listen, this is what I'm trying to say. I'm consistent with it. Go to MTV right now and Google Julius Jones and Matthew Scar Allen, and they both got on the stand and said, Sean pulled out his gun and aimed at me and squeezed off into me. You understand what I'm talking about? Pause. That's how that thing went down. And then the security from the club tried to grab my hand, and then the ratchet went off into the ceiling. But come on. Totally consistent. At the end of the day, you know, it was a terrible situation. It's a tragedy for my mom, a tragedy for everybody involved. It's 18 years later. I'm still banned from America, still banned from London, still banned from Canada. It's not a pretty thing. You know, I should be an example to young kids as to what happens when you engage in this lifestyle. It's not going to be a platinum record. It's not going to be millions of dollars. This is what's going to happen. You're not going to walk around in Fox Hill Mall and get knocked out in front of your son. No. You understand? Either you going to kill somebody, or somebody going to kill you, or you going to spend a decade or your lifetime in prison. You know what I'm saying? This rap thing is not the truth, man.
Are you bitter or disgruntled about any of that, having to do time? Or
Listen, at the end of the day, when people say that, my man, when I say I'm in Paris at the Plaza, ask for me, I'm really in Paris at the Plaza. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm good. Like, I'm good. Like, that's one of the reasons why, you know, I'm so focused on my relationship with God. You dig? It don't have nothing to do with changing and being square and being corny. Nah. Like, you got to have some type of divine intervention to endure what I've endured. But there's no bitterness. There's no nothing. There's just truth. I'm going to speak the truth like I know it. Drake should not be rapping about catching a body.
I'm with you on that. Now, we can agree on that.
And Officer Rick should not be talking about anything other than, you know, nice girls that he like or eating hamburgers or you know what I'm saying, his SAT scores. He not supposed to be no mobster rapper. I'm sorry, man.